description of this work called Ritual Meal. She set up a space called F-Space in Santa Ana, an experimental gallery where a number of performances were staged, including Chris Burden's notorious shoot and this Ritual Meal. She subsequently made the work in a gallery called Feed Me, where she spent a night, overnight in the gallery, naked, surrounded by food, oils, incense, possibly marijuana. And rumors quickly spread that she was having sex with visitors, which Suzanne Lacey says, you know, the real feminists were quite shocked about, although she subsequently gone on to really hold her office as a very key figure from the time. Ideas of sustenance, environmentalism, very important to such as Diane Dennis and her Wheatfield work. And other basics, sleep. Marta Minuin and Richard Squires created this installation within a gallery out of mattresses, and visitors were invited to go inside, hang out, sleep, dream, make out. They also staged parties with inside the environment, and this was remade for the fantastic wax show, which you had here. I don't know if you had that work. I hope you did, yes. Susan Heller, also the American-British-based artist, fascinated by sort of collective, collective unconscious, invited people to sleep together, I mean to sleep in the same field, and record their dreams, out of which she wove an installation and books. And Martha Russler, one of the great examples of an artist who's really kind of done very, very little to court the market, and in fact refused gallery representation, I think, way into the 80s. But because she is such a kick-ass artist, and so her working has, she finally started to, you know, over the last 10 years, has been very prominent. So she staged a yard sale in the gallery in 73. It's also listed restaged at the MTA in London in 2005. Here's a description of that. She's done a number of really very layered projects, such as If You Lived Here, which was an exhibition really inspired by the homeless crisis in New York. And as Yvonne Rainer says of the work, it was a vivid demonstration of how an art exhibition can constitute a radically different approach, one that can offer not only a diversity of objects, but contextualize a social field in and from which the objects are produced and derive their meaning. So an art exhibition does not have to separate or isolate its objects from the conditions in and under which those objects have been produced. And there were a number of activist groups invited to present the material as part of an exhibition that also has, you know, quote-unquote, artwork. And she's continued these very sort of collective expansive gestures. So recently she did a show which was lending her library up to institutions around the world. So, given this legacy of art inspired by feminism, we have to ask, what is the problem? Why, with few exceptions, have recent accounts of relational aesthetics been so reluctant to acknowledge this history upon which the work that they celebrate seems to draw? Why do female artists who employ tropes of domesticity, service, and intimacy encountered in their work seem to meet a different critical fate to male artists who use similar devices? At the heart of this problem seem to be stubborn ideas about the avant-garde as an agent for shock, disruption, and rupture. This puts women artists in a difficult position where this kind of work is concerned. So where a male artist, such as Reckitt, can organize a dinner party in a gallery, or decorate its lobby as an artwork, or design a restaurant, as a work of art and be celebrated as aesthetically audacious. A woman doing something similar would probably barely register. Her gestures reiterate conventional expectations of female labor and the woman's realm. She acts as expected just like a woman. Which is why Mara Lady Winnie Kelly felt compelled to record all, to recode all of her domestic labor of art and in the protest contest the avant-garde insistence on negation, knowing that any other strategy would fail to account for the problematic divisions of labor that were lying in plain sight. Of course, the inverse did not apply to the way that prominent male artists at the time were perceived. The art world saw nothing gendered about art made by men using bulldozers and dump trucks, Robert Smithson, Michael Heiser, industrial fabrication processes, Richard Serra, Donald Judd, Solar Whip, or building materials, Robert Morris, Carl Andre. Although, as Alyssa also argues in an interesting new recent book called String Felt Theory, The Hierarchy of Art and Craft in American Art, Carl Andre was vigilant in protesting these art claims with domesticity. So when a review came out of his work in Art Forum that likened his metal floor work to rugs, he wrote back and emphasized that this was absolutely not where he was coming from, and stressed his affiliation with the butch practice and working class practice of bricklaying. So against this backdrop, I think Linda, So against this backdrop, I think Linda Benglis's self-portrait of the dildo-wielding porn star is absolutely perfect. This was an ad for her show at the Paula Cooper Gallery. It was a companion to Robert Morris's self-portrait of himself as an SM kickster in Helmet and Chain. And it was published in Art Forum in the same issue as an article about her work by Robert Pinkett Whitten. And I don't really have time to go into this, but it led to the resignation of most Art Forum editors on the grounds of sort of vulgarity and anti-feminism. And then they went on to set up the extremely unvulgar organ called October. I mean, in the article published in that issue, her point is really clear. She says, art in New York is all about territory. So there is only one pertinent question, how big? How big is the zone you capture and occupy with your painting, your floor sculpture, your video piece, your public persona? How powerful is the image that establishes your presence? So the problem of women dealing with domestic tropes was recognized in 1973 by the pioneering feminist critic and curator Julie Joyce, who I mentioned earlier, with her characteristic ability to call space a shovel. In her article, Household Images in Art, she notes, probably more than most artists, women make art to escape, overwhelm, or transform daily realities. So it makes sense that those women artists who do focus on domestic imagery often seem to be taking off from, rather than getting off on, the implications of floors and grooves and dirty laundry. They work through such imagery because it's there, because they know it, because it's what they know best, because they can't escape it. Lippard continues. Of course, men have dealt with domestic imagery. In the early 60s, the male artist moved into women's domain and pillaged with impunity. The result was pop art, the most popular American artist ever. If the first major pop art had been women, the movement might never have gotten out of the kitchen. Then it would have struck those same critics who welcomed and eulogized pop art as just women making more genre art. But since it was primarily men who were painting and sculpting the unusual dishwashers, appliances, food, soap pads, or soup cans, the choice of imagery was considered a breakthrough. So where male artists could, and I think still can, draw a perverse and uncanny charge from their appropriations of household imagery, women resisted, knowing, as Lippard points out, they couldn't afford to be called feminine artists. The implications of inferiority having been all too precisely learned from experience. And just three decades earlier, Simone de Beauvoir in the second sex had discussed the dichotomy between transcendence and imminence, I just mentioned that, in gender relations, and correlated women's domestic confinement with their perceived lack of creativity. A perception that de Beauvoir argued women themselves internalized. So where feminists like Judy Chicago and Miriam Shapiro subsequently valorized female-dominated craft and decorative traditions as well as evidence of women's self-expression against the odds. For de Beauvoir, domesticity always remained a trap. Few tasks were more like the torture of Sisyphus than housework, with its endless repetition. The clean becomes soiled, the soiled is made clean over and over, day after day, which sounds like a scripture of some woman has performed as well as her arraignment. She was also brilliant on the pathetic search for praise that the housewife seeks for her domestic and culinary achievements, and her biographer, D. Joubert, details the squalor in which the housework-resistant philosopher chose to live in. Today, in our contemporary culture of stitch and bitch, ironic cupcakes, and a resurgence of interest in skills associated with everything from homemade baking to artisanal cheeses, I think women can enjoy a less vexed relationship to domesticity. Yet the art world can be a very old-fashioned place, especially where aesthetics and the market come into play. As examples of male artists who've formed successful careers using female-coated materials like Mike Kelly and his found toy and second-hand garish textiles remind us. Just compare the critical reputation and market value of Kelly versus an artist just 10 years his senior, such as Harmony Hammond, whose appropriation of textiles was rather dourly earnest in contrast to the subversive irony of Kelly's approach. And this is an ironic example because Mike Kelly has acknowledged how important the woman house was to him when he showed up at Calart several years later. The difference being that his appropriations are kind of known and ironic. So I think one of the issues that we always have to think about with artists, women artists, using their bodies is how difficult it still is, how the use of the body for female artists often falls back into certain stereotypes. So on the one hand, the avant-garde favors a certain kind of spectacular sexualized presentation of female corporeality that challenges ideas of passivity, matronliness, and demureness, which is probably why the female artists who have been celebrated in this realm are those whose attractive, youthful, new bodies feature prominently in their work. But there's also an aversion to female bodies, especially those that don't conform to conventional standards of beauty. Connie Butler, who was responsible for the WAC exhibition, when I chatted to her about that exhibition, talked about meeting a French museum director while she was working on the show, and his horror that she was excluding men. She said, I could sense his physical disgust and embarrassment even about the idea of a museum show with only female artists. And colleagues elsewhere advised Connie Butler against organizing this show, telling her it would be career suicide, and often asked me what I was going to do about all that ugly art by which, she said, I'm sure they meant depictions of female bodies. The art world has long feared explicit sexual content, especially in work by women. We can see this bias in comments from 1969 by Mama curator William Rubin in an essay about the sculpture of Louise Bourgeois, where he wrote, when scenes of sexuality are pressed too literally, a set of emotions interposes itself between the viewer and the work, unconducive to aesthetic contemplation. So in art and in life, the gender of bodies still matters. Argues the critic Christine Wertheim, though many social or material tasks might now count as work, it still depends on who performs the task as much as where it is done. When work studies are conducted by even such august bodies as the United Nations, if a man gathers wood or carries water from a well, it counts as work. When a woman does exactly the same activity, it is not